without further ado, over to Mogens Jensen now. And everybody, please hang out with us if you can for the 15-minute after both talk discussion when we can chat more about the questions we didn't get to. Over to you, Mogens.
Thank you very much. It's a really great pleasure for me, Sri, to, I probably have to do this, to talk at this fantastic series. I'm very happy you, most of you guys are in the United States. I'm sitting here in colder and colder Copenhagen. And my talk today is about chaos in cells. And we have, over the last 5 years, looked quite a lot what happens to both TLK and SYK cells when they are damaged or inflamed. And it turns out that famous proteins like P53 is a cancer protein, and NF-kappa B is a diabetes protein, oscillates in time. You see some oscillations here. And what we have advocated is to try to couple an external oscillator onto the internal oscillator. Then you can get what's called Arnold tongues. And I come back to that. That's something I have worked on back 30 years ago in Chicago, and I have come back to. And you can also see chaotic behavior when many tongues overlap. These oscillations, of course, in the model is made possible by a negative feedback loop. I just defined that briefly. So as I said, we add an external protein oscillation and it tried to couple to the internal one. And these two oscillators sometimes, not always, synchronized and lead to these Arnold tongues. I'm a modeler here in Copenhagen, but we have data from Harvard, Beijing, and Chicago these days. Very good collaboration. So last year we asked ourselves whether deterministic chaos is really relevant for gene production. And to our big surprise, we were able to show that it is in some cases. So that leads us to speculate that by these two coupled oscillators, can you do gene control or maybe even diagnostics? It turns out that various cancer cells might oscillate differently with different pairs and amplitudes. Also mutations give variations in the oscillations. So that I come to in the end. But just to show you exactly what kind of data we work with, this is from our two collaborators here. So Galit Lahav group at Harvard, probably many of you know, she has been a pioneer in studies of P53 oscillations. And what you see here is if you do double strand breaks, then you see that the level of P53 in single cell oscillate nice and smoothly over actually many days. Of course, not like as beautiful as a pendulum, you have noise inside cells. And here I showed data from Marcus Covert in at Stanford that you put TNF, a cytokine, onto normal mouse human cells, and you see the transcription factor NF-kappa-B also oscillates over almost a day. So our question has been the last 5 years, can we control and understand it and maybe even use it for diagnostics and things like this? Now, many of you probably know these two very fundamental transcription factors. P53 is a famous cancer gene. It's probably one of the most studied proteins in the world. It's mutated in basically all cancers, and people say a high value of P53 prevents cancer. On the other hand, leads to apoptosis, so it's a delicate balance. And NF-kappa-B is another famous transcription factor controlling over 300 genes, probably actually 500. It's upregulated by inflammation, and many people in diabetes study NF-kappa-B. So I just here more graphically indicate our suggestions. So here I have a little schematic picture of the NF-kappa-B system. NF-kappa-B promotes another protein called I-kappa-B. It's an inhibitor of NF-kappa-B, and they bind to each other. I come back to that in a second. This is triggered from outside by a tumor necrosis factor, TNF-alpha, at a certain level. But we suggested some years ago that one should try to oscillate from outside this TNF in time, then maybe it would couple, as you see inside here, to the internal oscillator. And the whole question is, do this external oscillator couple into this internal oscillator? And of course, I wouldn't be talking here if it wasn't the case, exactly this case, they do couple. Sometimes they don't couple, but here they do. But I want to take you on a little physics tour first. I'm a physicist, and synchronization of two oscillators go way back 350 years, actually, to the famous Dutch physicist Huygens. I'm sure many of you have heard of in hydrodynamics and so on. The story is he was lying in bed with a fever and there were two clocks on the wall, and Huygens realized, oh, after some time, they actually synchronized. We all know this. So with his father, he built this ingenious picture, which actually my late mentor Leo Kavanagh found in an old book. And you have two chairs and you have a piece of wood in between, and then you put two watches with big pendula on this, and Huygens and his father found if they were far apart, they didn't synchronize, and if they were close to each other here, they synchronized. This is like two metronomes on a piano, and we all know that they can, through the vibrations in the wood and in the piano, synchronize. So that's a whole, of course, very fundamental question, which, funny enough, is still unsolved. So if you have two independent oscillators, it's very important they're independent. If one is kind of a spring and the other one oscillates, it's a driven oscillator, right? And that's a resonance phenomena. It's different. Here we have two independent oscillators. And if they are simply related to each other, maybe one is twice the other, you have a periodic structure. Here I just show a kind of abstract phase space. It's actually from a pendulum. It doesn't really matter. But it's periodic and comes back to itself. Also what we in solid state physics call commensurate. If the two frequencies are not rationally related, then in phase space you have what's called a quasi-periodic motion. You have it goes around in phase space. It never comes back to its starting point, but infinitely close, and traces up a nice pattern in phase space. We also in solid state physics call this incommensurate. If the two oscillators couple even stronger, then you can get into a chaotic regime where you have a broad band spectrum of frequencies and you have what's called a strange attractor. And I'm sure many of you know what chaos is, but you might think it's kind of random. It has some deterministic randomness, but mathematically it's very, very well defined by the fact that two nearby points diverge from each other exponentially. So here it also never comes back, but in a completely different way. And it's quite interesting for me because the first time we looked at this is 35 years ago with Pierre Bach and Thomas More. And we derived what's this called Arnold-Tong diagram. And I just briefly want to go through this because it's quite fundamental for what I'm going to say. On the x-axis here, you have the frequency of what the external oscillator, and here on the y-axis, you have the coupling. And let me take the 1/1 tong. That means that you can vary the external frequency of oscillator and pull the internal oscillator towards you such that the ratio is exactly 1/1. And you can do that in an interval. And you can have that one is twice the other, the internal is twice the external. Then you can also pull the internal one to the external one. You can vary the external and they will couple to each other, synchronize to each other. And the funny thing is you have this tongue for each and every rational number. And they get wider as the coupling increases. So at some point they must overlap. And what I indicated here, when two tongues overlap, it's green. And when many tongues overlap, it's red. And you have chaotic motion here. So it's a funny situation. You go from the real axis down here where rational numbers are dense but has zero measure. Irrational numbers have full measure. All the rational widen. And at this critical line, the rationals has full measure and the irrationals has zero measure, but they're still all there. And from a number theoretical point of view, it's extremely interesting, this diagram, and actually not understood. Now you can find many examples of Arnold-Tongs on the net and very beautiful pictures and so on. And actually I have given this talk many times in California where I always show a real Arnold-Tong. So, in the 80s, I worked several years at the University of Chicago Bay, and in the basement, we did experiments in the following way. It's a famous experiment devised by Albert Lipschaber. You have a matchbox and you heat, you have a fluid you heat from below and you get convection rolls, I think we all know. Now, if you heat a little more, you have an oscillatory instability. And if you measure temperature on top here on the cell, you get a beautiful, beautiful oscillator that can go for weeks. Now, when I came, they were shifting to mercury, and we discussed that maybe one could put an external oscillator on. And actually what we did with these people was to put an external current running across the cell here, and it happened that the external oscillator coupled to the internal. It sounds easy, actually took several years to get it to work, but we found beautiful, beautiful Arnold tongues, and to a very high degree, we could actually find Arnold tongues with denominator. It's extremely stable experiment. So denominator were up to 100. And we could approach the golden mean. Now you might think golden mean has something to do with paintings, but we can, you know, the golden mean can be approached by Fibonacci numbers. And we could approach the golden mean with accuracy 0.1% or something like this, and hit the golden mean there, where the experiment were kind of, is very special. So you had a transition to chaos at the golden mean point. I don't have time to discuss this more, but it's quite interesting setup. So actually irrational numbers mean something here. We actually also approach what you call silver mean. Okay, so we published this a few years ago, what I come to in a second in biology, and we actually had the editor put Arnold tongues in front of cell system on the front page. We thought was very nice. The editor said, oh, it looks like sunrise, which is kind of true. Now with my late mentor, Leo Kavanov, we started to discuss this 7 years ago. And of course we had done this in physics, and I hadn't thought about it for around 25 years. But with Leo, we discussed, what about biology? There are many, many oscillators. We, all you guys know, cell cycle, of course, with period of hours, circadian clock, we all know from jet lag, 24 hours, calcium oscillation, seconds, embryos, also periods of hours, and that's what formed this, our spinal cord, pacemaker, and the heart is fast. And here I show you for protein oscillations from DNA damage and population dynamics, you have time scales of years or maybe millions of years. So there are many, many oscillators in the biological world. Actually, I would like to say we are built on top of oscillators. All you guys probably know, but if we have, how do we have get oscillation if we have a genetic regulation? Well, here I have a genetic loop. We have some positive, that protein 3 is positive on protein 4. Protein 4 is negative on protein 5. And you need an odd number of the negative ones to have a negative feedback loop. And you need a negative feedback loop to induce oscillations. A very nice, simple one, which actually we also worked on some years ago, is that the protein HES1 is negative on itself. Here with some time delay, now my mouse is getting slow, but anyway, so it's negative on itself, and you can induce a time delay, and you can go from the steady state to sustained oscillations. And down here to the left, I have a very famous one called repressilator by Elowitz and Leibler, exactly 20 years ago. They build in 3 negative genes on itself, so you have a negative feedback loop, and indeed, they found beautiful oscillations inside bacteria. What we have in the negative feedback loop is that we have 2 proteins, and they couple in a complex. That's make 1 protein not free, and in that sense, it's a negative feedback loop. So here I show you the so-called genetic network of the P53 and NF-kappa-B, and this is because we did in particular with Sandy Krishna and many graduate students, and we collected all data in the world and tried to draw this genetic network for P53, which is excited by radiation. And here's also NF-kappa-B, which is excited by inflammation. And here we have maybe 15, 20 proteins both places, and we found it was much too much. We want to simplify them. Here I follow another of my mentors, Niels Bohr. He always said we have to simplify in order to understand. Some biologists, some of you guys do not like this, but we did this. And it's an interesting discussion between biology and physics, actually.
Moens, I'm yes? just with a clarification question from Suraj. Are yes? the relaxation oscillators in the repressilator and other examples shown?
Relaxation oscillators, absolutely. Yep. Yeah, you can get relaxation oscillators, and or you can get sustained. Yep, absolutely. So we simplify them here, and what we did was just to include two proteins and messenger RNA. And here NF-kappa-B and I-kappa-B, they bind in a complex, and that's why it's a negative loop. It's exactly the same for P53. It promotes MDM2, which is an inhibitor, because it binds in a complex to P53, is not free. And we derived this highly nonlinear differential equation. I don't have time to go into this, but we reduced the big system to three coupled ordinary differential equations. They all showed oscillations, either damped oscillations or stable, stable states or stable oscillations. We could go through the whole thing and actually agree with many, many experiments. So I work quite closely with Galit Lahau group now, and we also look at, I just want to tell, at knockouts. If you knock out another protein, MDMX, you can also induce oscillations. So here we show the double strand break I showed in the beginning by DNA damage, but you can also knock out some genes in the network I showed before, and then you can also induce oscillations. We can induce oscillations in various ways, and we just have a very recent paper where we try to model this. I just look at the time. I still have around 10 minutes, yeah. And I now come to that. Also, Marcus Covert a few years ago sent me these beautiful traces of NF-kappa-B in single cells. So again, the period here is hours. It's 2 to 3 hours. In P53, is more 3 to 5, 6 hours. It's called what we call ultradian oscillations. Not circadian, not fast, ultradian. And Marcus actually asked me, oh, do you think this trace here is chaotic? And in dynamical systems, we have a beautiful technique to, if you have a time series, you can embed it in higher dimensions called embedding, targets embedding. I'm sure some of you know. And I tried to embed these data series I could, and you know, you're supposed to look for a strange attractor. You can see some indication of it, but it was not clear. I couldn't say whether it's chaos or not. And therefore, after discussion with Leo Kavanagh, we came to this idea I showed you in the beginning, that maybe we can better induce chaos and actually control the oscillation better by an external oscillator. And so maybe we can also then control DNA repair, gene production, and so on. I show you very shortly in the end. So this I did with Sandeep Krishna. And just to show very briefly, the 1/1 tongue is where the external TNF, which is green, and internal are completely in phase, are completely locked to each other. But if tongues overlap, you can have two. You can have the 1/3 where external makes 3 and internal 1, or 1/2 where external makes 2 periods when internal make 1. They overlap. And then it depends on the initial conditions, which one you go to. So this is essential for the biological systems I come to in a second. If many tongues overlap, you get a strange attractor, it becomes chaotic. So I got a fantastic collaboration with Savas Thai and Ryan Kellogg. We're in Zurich now. Savas is Chicago, Ryan is in Stanford, and they actually have this NF-kappa-B cells in channel flow. And first they tried to put a constant TNF and they found nice oscillations. And then they began to oscillate TNF in this here microflow. And that's exactly what we wanted them to do. So here you see the external TNF is by the vertical line here. And the internal oscillators is NF-kappa-B in these cells here. And after some time you see beautiful, beautiful synchronization in the 1/1 tongue, right? One period to one period. Sometimes they didn't synchronize. It depended on the external period and the external amplitude as it should. And I do not have, let me see, look at the clock. I do not have much time. So then I talked a lot to Savas and said, do you sometimes see maybe that the time series of your NF-kappa-B oscillators jump between two states? And he says, it's really funny you say that, because very often we see we go from what we call 1/1 to 1/2, back to 1/1 to 1/2. Ah, but that means you are in the overlap between two Arnold tongues. Why? Because as I showed you before, there can be two solutions, one belonging to 1/1 tongue, the other to 1/2 tongues. And it depends on initial conditions, but in the cell you have internal noise. So if you have internal noise, you will jump between these two states, and we call this mode hopping. And of course, we can do simulations of our model with my student Matthias Helfberg. And we did simulations and put ourselves exactly at a situation where we have two overlapping tongues over B here. And then if I go down here, now my you see it jumps back and forth between the solutions of the two tongues. Of course, we can tune the noise in Gillespie simulations. So we could, exactly as they saw in the experiment I show here, jump. They jump between two states. Well, of course, if we take our NF kappa B equations and put exactly on a situation where we have two tongues overlapping, well, we should also, by adding noise, be able to see jumping between the two states. So we call this mode hopping or multiplexing. And is that relevant now for anything now? This is, well, then we began to devise here that we looked at the downstream gene and we began to play with cooperativity, how many molecules of NF kappa B binds and how the affinity, how strong does it bind? This is gene one. Here you have higher cooperativity and lower affinity. And what we found was the production was exactly out of phase, that the production of the two genes depended exactly on whether the NF kappa B production was in one tongue, as you see here is one tongue here is one and a half is red and the other one is blue. It depended exactly for protein one, it depended exactly on whether it was in one tongue or the other and was opposite of the other protein. And therefore the total production, as you see here, is out of phase and it jumps between the two Arnold tongues. And so this is just a model. We predict that indeed for downstream genes, it's be very important. We can actually control, this is what I said before, the production of the different genes depending on their cooperativity and affinity. So now I went from a single solution, just a stable state one oscillation to mode hopping. And then if we push the amplitude of TNF higher, we should get into this chaotic state. And this is the last thing I'm going to say. Again,
just to let you know, you have 1 minute.
I have 1 minute. So we looked at, again, played with a downstream gene, and we increased the amplitude. And what we saw was, if we have medium cooperativity and high affinity, in chaos, production of the gene went down. If we had high cooperativity and low affinity in chaos, the production of the gene went up. We were completely surprised by these results. We now think about whether we can use this maybe in diagnostics. So since I have 1 minute, I want to thank all my collaborators. Really started with my late mentor, Leo Kalender, who Sri knew very well. I have collaboration, Gilead Labs, Harvard, Sandy Krishma, Chicago, Stanford, so on, and Weizmann, and Beijing. We have some recent papers, and I want to show the last, I am not sure I dare. It was this paper about chaos. But since you guys most live in the United States, I have to show this strange here, that actually we got 2 pages about this paper in Breitbart News. And I feel both a little ashamed to show it, but it's, as we know, it's Trump news, but actually they described our research extremely well. And I have met other researchers who actually also had their research in Breitbart News. So maybe they like research, I don't know. With this, I want to thank you. And here I have my funding, Danish Research Foundation and Research Funds. Thanks a lot.
Well, thank you, Mogens. I'm going to jump straight into questions. First, from a question from Suraj Shankar at 1153. Are the jumps between the two stable states stochastic or also periodic in the region of the Arnold tongue overlap?
It's a fantastic question. So it depends on where you are in the Arnold tongues. If you kind of are in the middle of the overlap, it kind of spends equal time in one tongue compared to the other. If we move it a little bit, you can be 90% in one tongue and 10% in the other. The jumping is always stochastic, but there might be sometimes some memory. It's a fantastic question. We have looked at quite a lot.
Next, I'm going to jump to a question from Sriram Ramaswamy at 1154. In the experiments, the system mode hop just after a couple of oscillations. Do you observe in the experiment longer residence in each state?
It's exactly related to the previous question, right? That, well, I mean, we can certainly see in the model. These experiments are not easy, so, but for sure, we got hundreds of cells for SAVAS, and some indeed stayed much longer time in the one tongue compared to the other. So the question is, yes, sometimes you have much longer time series in one compared to the other. Indeed, I showed more or less where they were equal. A great question.
Question from Jing Chen at 1156. How many overlapping tongues lead to chaos?
I'm sorry to keep saying it's a fantastic question too. So you see, many tongues begin to overlap. Then some becomes unstable. So what I showed you was overlap of two tongues where you have two stable solutions. Now, when you move further up, you get more and more tongues overlapping. Many more become unstable. And actually, when you go into chaos, you have an infinity of unstable solutions. You have an infinity of overlapping tongues.
So question from Navish Vadva at 1158. Is there a hope of seeing chaos in experiments? If yes, would it be distinguishable from noise? And to his question, I want to tag on my own question, which is there an organizational principle why biology seems to be very good at avoiding chaos?
Yeah, of course, also a good question. We have looked a lot at that. It's a little bit hard, of course, as the question allude to distinguish deterministic noise from stochastic noise. But there are some tricks. One can do some smoothing. One can try to check whether there's indication of, as I said early on, possibly Lyapunov exponent. And with my student, we have actually done some checks on this. And I definitely believe that chaos can be observed in the biological system. You do see it for calcium oscillations and other things. Here we have slower timescales. And of course, we always tell our experimental collaborators, we want as long time as possible in order to identify chaos. But that is why I indicate to you a very, very specific pathway here. That's why it's a good pathway, because we have very, very good control here of when we go into chaos, and this we can tell our experimental colleagues. I'm completely sure it will be observed. But it's a good question again.
Let me wrap up with a final, very speculative question, or rather a question about speculations. Rudra Biswas wants to know, are there connections between nonlinear oscillators, say, such as the turbulence example you showed early on, and, quote, time crystals? And then he has sent a clarification about what he means by time crystals. So let me just read that so everybody's on the same page. Time crystals are things that move perpetually in their ground state in an oscillatory or rotational way. So if you have...
I'm sorry. So it's a crystal in kind of equilibrium, but there's it rotates in its states. Is that what it is?
Yes.
Okay. Very good. Very good point. So there, I presume it's in equilibrium. A crystal have a Hamiltonian, and it has a equilibrium state. And whether this oscillation is an equilibrium state, I don't know. But there's a big difference being an equilibrium and non-equilibrium state. What I show today is highly out of equilibrium. So, but people have studied Arnold tongues to an incredible degree for equilibrium system also. There's an anisotropic isomer model. I did my PhD on that. I could talk about that for hours. So let me think here. It was a question whether one can see locking between states or chaos. Was that the...
So I'm actually going to give Rudra a chance to further clarify his question.
Okay.
In the interest of time, let's wrap up two terrific talks and lots of exciting discussions officially here and jump into further discussions in the 15-minute informal chat period. So everybody, time to clap and let's officially close the discussions, the formal discussions, and open informal discussions.